Well, good morning. It's wonderful to be here. Please stand as we worship this morning.
Jesus.
idea of sacrifice. As we are entering a season of Lent, we're in it. And what a wonderful thing it is that we deserve nothing and God gave us everything. And we give as a symbol for the things that he did for us. So hear these words, paraphrase from Psalm 51. Have mercy on us, O God, according to your unfailing love, according to your great compassions, blot out our transgressions. Wash away all our transgressions and our sin that's always before us. Against you, O God, we have only sinned and we have done what is evil in your sight. But cleanse us, God. Create in us a pure heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within us. What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. And all precious is the flow. offering is for New Life Ministries. We've been showing you a couple of slideshows for the past couple of months, just highlight the various different ministries that we have going on here. And it is a privilege, I work with the youth, to just see them grow and see them prosper. And this time you get to see the gems, what they're up to. And as we do, you can give in those boxes in front of me, and we're going to sing a song.
I assumed the clapping was for them, not for me, which is totally okay. My name is Paula, and I am, whether you like it or not, your host for this morning. It's 2 minutes of pure bliss with no mask on. Still waiting for Taylor to ask me to do a sermon, and I could do 20 minutes without. Not sure that'll ever happen, but girl can wish, right? If you're new to this church, please fill out a connect card. We would love to hear from you and how we can help you and serve you and maybe what you can do for us. And they are, if you're here, they're in the seat pocket in front of you. Just put it in one of the collection boxes or at the info booth. and somebody will get in touch with you. Again, it's not going to be me. Little disturbing for me to read in my outline is that if you are online and there is a host, an online host that will help you and you can submit it right away, my fear is that I'm going to be replaced by an online host as well here. But will that host be your sarcastic little ray of sunshine is the question. There's a missions trip fundraiser for youth from March 16 to 20. They will be going into the Vancouver downtown east side to serve and to see the social issues that people there are dealing with, the obstacles that people are facing there in an urban setting, just to see what they can do in Jesus' name and maybe even just be able to fix some of the issues. It will be a challenge for them, but they will see that God loves us all, no matter if you're in the downtown east side or here. For this fundraiser, there will also, for this trip, there will also be a small fundraiser and a commissioning next week. The fundraiser is a soup lunch, which is just fantastic. I mean, really. So I encourage everybody to just encourage these kids to do their thing in the downtown east side, and it is just so needed. And we know that you've given before to youth trips, but we hope that your generosity will bless them and encourage them to do the Lord's work there. Please also commit this trip to prayer, and they will feel encouraged and know that our church stands behind them in this trip. Another fun thing happening is Adopt a Farmer's Field Day next week. Or Saturday. It's Adopt a Field. I kind of read it wrong and I thought adopt like an animal. Apparently the cows are counted in these barns. It's really rude. If this changes, I just want to say I call dibs on the little goat at Mike and Teresa Flores' farm. That one should be mine, really. But anyway, it's a community-based project. You may have already heard or seen anything, seen things on social media. At church, we're encouraging participation, which can be your small group, which can be your family, which can be a group of friends. That's next week, Saturday. It's to clean up debris from the fields so that the farmers can actually get into the fields and get their work done. Super important, of course, this coming Saturday. If you can help, please get in touch with Jimmy Mayer at FraserValleyFloodRelief@gmail.com. FraserValleyFloodRelief@gmail.com. You may also grab your phone now just to put in her number. It's 604-309-3203. I will repeat it. Grab your phone. 604-309-3203. And Jimmy would love to hear from you. She's amazing. She will give you further instruction on what's happening. Kids dismissal. Rumor has it that kids that are not picked up will be going home with the host. I don't want them. I think they're lovely. No. No. But yeah, they're here. If you have not signed them in yet, then please do so at the kiosk. If you are new to this church, please find a kids' church attendant who will help you through the process and for them to go where they need to go. The Little Lights will be going through that door over there. Kids grades 1 through 5 will go through that door over there. Just letting you know that next week is the last day for Kids Church. Next week there will be no Kids Church because of spring break and the volunteers that are so happily and loyally serving your children downstairs will be enjoying a fantastic break. And I just want, like, I was one of the moms, like, enjoying a break while my kids were in kids' church, and just give them a hand. Like, these volunteers are just worth gold. Fellowship time. We're coming up on our 3 minutes of saying hi. Please wear your mask and respect each other's personal space. If wanted, needed, I don't know. A little scary these days. Please welcome each other, find a new face, and maybe ask each other, what are you giving up for Lent? Good question. That's a heavy one. Thank you for having me, and enjoy your Sunday.
Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever say, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you.
All right. Well, good morning. Welcome again to New Life. It's good to be here. And welcome again to those online as well. So this morning, before I carry on, I wanted to mention some of the things that have been talked about in the Encourager and so on. And in addition to that, of course, reflect on the war in Ukraine, which I suspect weighs heavy on our hearts, changes our whole world situation, and that's a big deal. Not to mention that All of us are still wrestling with lingering pandemic issues and so on, and perhaps running out of patience or one way or another and all of that. So we live in difficult times, and I wanted to raise awareness of that and commit that to prayer. In addition to that, of course, on Friday, we lost one of our members, Al Hoogie, had a short battle with cancer, diagnosed only in October, and passed away on Friday morning. And so we want to remember that in prayer as well. And as well, a couple of resignations, one from Eric Hugenrad, serving as chair of the Board of Elders, has resigned. And so that weighs heavy on us. As well, the news of Justin also making a move. And so all of that is, it's heavy stuff. And we on Friday, we were talking about it here at staff and recognizing that a lot of bad news in the encourager, we might need to relabel it as the discourager. And that's the reason why I want to bring it up as well, is certainly don't want it to be discouragement. It's said that discouragement is the primary tool that the devil uses to draw us away from God. And so I want to do the very opposite and draw us into the presence of God this morning. And then with Justin's move, I'm going to invite Justin up to just talk with you a little bit about that and explain a little bit more of what he and his family are up to and try to extend some grace to him.
I don't know if I've been more nervous standing up here before, so my family and I would love your grace. So if you did not read in the Encourager and you just heard from Nathan, my family and I are moving to Saskatchewan to be close to Nicole's family and then closer to my family as well. It wasn't a decision that we came to lightly, and it's not a decision that we're necessarily thrilled about. It's a very bittersweet decision for us because over the last 10 years of being here at New Life, even though our family is not present here, our biological families, you have become a family to us in so many ways. I was just reflecting on when a child here gets baptized and dedicated, and there's a promise that the church makes to support, pray for, and come alongside that child. And we've seen that for all four of our kids here and for ourselves. And we've felt so supported by all of you. And this church has just been amazing. I couldn't have asked for anything better. Nicole and I, over the years, have adopted a process of just praying every year and asking God, where do you have us? What are you calling us into? We want to make sure that we're still in your plan. And over the last few years, we've felt like God is saying, there's a new season coming, there's a new season coming, there's a new season coming. And we didn't get any clarity for years, those few years. But in November, we spent time in prayer just asking God for clarity because we felt it coming more urgently, if you will. And then God gave us peace that it was to move and to be close to her family in Saskatchewan. And so we're excited for a new season and of what God's going to bring us into, but we're also sad and heavy-hearted to leave family all of you for a season. So if you're ever out in Saskatchewan, come visit. We would love to see your faces. I don't know what else I should share here. I don't know. It's gonna be hard. We're gonna be here until the end of June. The kids are gonna finish out their school year at ACS, Lord willing, and then I'll be able to finish out into the summer here and continue to work with life groups, young adults, youth, everything, and try to do well to help transition hopefully the next pastor or ministry leaders, and just continue to see God, have New Life thrive. So I think one of the things I wanted to, as I process this, one of the things is like when someone leaves and you care about somebody that way, hopefully you guys care about me, when someone leaves that you care about, you think, oh, I'm losing somebody. But I believe that God has a new season in store for New Life. He has a new season in store for my family, but I believe that God has a new season in store for this church. And I trust that he's going to bring that new season about as well. And so my prayer is that God continues to draw this congregation closer and closer to himself through that new season. And I'll be praying for that for you all. Yeah, and if you have any questions, please feel free to come talk to me.
All right. I understand you've already received several punches for, that's the grace.
Yeah, I didn't know people were so violent here. So just, good luck.
No, bless you. And we'll carry on together. As in the meantime, I want to encourage the congregation as well that Justin's not gone yet, so he continues to serve as a pastor of small groups and young adults. And so, you're here till the end of June, right? And yes, good. All right, thank you, Justin. So all of these things, I want us to come together in prayer. And I was going to preach about worship as a dangerous act. We're in that series. Janessa began it last week. And part of my message was to acknowledge that sometimes the danger of worship is that we have our own agenda for worship and we end up excluding God altogether. And as I thought about that, I thought, that could well be our danger here this morning if we don't spend some time just entreating God to enter into our lives, into our world, and recognize how dependent we are on God. And so I want to lead us in a time of prayer for each of these things. With respect to Al Hoagie, please continue to lift up the family in prayer, particularly Jean. We want to pray for comfort and strength. A memorial service will be held here at New Life on this coming Thursday, March the 10th, at 2:30 in the afternoon, on Thursday, 2:30. We also have, it's going to be a crazy busy week. We've got classes here. Classes is area churches. Each church sends a delegation of leaders to gather together to discuss issues of the denomination. One of the things that will be talked about is a human sexuality report that the denomination is coming out on. And we're going to be, actually the delegation from our church is myself and Janice Kostelik, and along with another church, we're called to advise on that human sexuality report, so that's going to be a big task. I just really want to covet your prayers as we process all of these things. So pray for Al Hoagie's family, for comfort and strength. Let's pray for our brothers and sisters in the Ukraine as well. This past week, I've been reading from Psalm 91 following a reading schedule, and each day was Psalm 91. And these words kept hitting me in thinking about fellow Christians even in the Ukraine. Psalm 91 verse 9 says, if you say, If you say the Lord is my refuge, and you make the Most High your dwelling, no harm will overtake you. No disaster will come near your tent, for he will command his angels concerning you to guard you in all your ways. And a couple of mornings, I sat quite perplexed reading that, thinking, that's just not true for my fellow brothers and sisters in the Ukraine who confess that the Lord is their refuge. They don't seem to be protected. And on the one hand, we could simply rebel in our faith and say, well, then that doesn't mean anything. Or, and what I want to encourage us to do this morning, is to simply sit in silence. We live in a very noisy culture. Not only noisy with noise, but also with our own resources and with our own thoughts and intellect. And we think that we can do everything on our own, and only once in a while do we need God to help us, to get us out of a jam. And that's just bad faith, to think that God is that optional. And so I want to invite you, as we reflect on these items, the war in Ukraine, lingering pandemic, and all of the frustration that that brings on for us, Al Hugi's passing away, the resignation of Eric Hugenrad, one of the leaders of our church, and let me remind you that when we commission leaders here, you say you will support leadership, you will encourage them, you will honor them, and then with the resignation of Justin in the big move that he and his family have ahead of them. I mean, that all sits with us, and perhaps some of that information or all of that information, we just don't know what to do with it, and we want to do something. And I think Scripture calls us to sit in silence, reminding ourselves perhaps of the story of Elijah. After a great victory, he showed off God's great might and power on Mount Carmel when he challenged the priests of Baal to have a sacrifice and to call down fire from heaven. And it just didn't happen. And then Elijah hosts a sacrifice to his God. And he calls down fire from heaven and it burns up the rock even. Powerful demonstration. And after that, Elijah just doesn't know what to do with himself. And he thinks he's all alone. And God just calls him to sit in silence. And so I invite you this morning, as we begin this time of prayer, I'm going to invite you later on to just pray in groups as well, but for now, as you sit there, just be silent. You don't have to offer any words to God. Forgive me. Sometimes we just have to shut up. And in the perplexity of our world, to only submit to God. And that requires us to quiet all of the wrestling that we want to do and all of the ambition that we think we can do to fix all of the problems, to sit in silence. I invite you into that silence. Lord, have mercy. Have mercy on us, O God. You are Lord. You are the God of heaven and earth. It's uncomfortable to sit in silence. We don't like it. Especially in this kind of situation where we expect always to be at least maybe some music or something to cover it all up. So I want you to present these things to God. The war in the Ukraine. Just the entire world situation. Let's face it, it's a scary world these days. Part of it's due to the pandemic. It's just put everybody on edge, it seems. But there's changing tides, too. I want you to lift that up to God. And then here at New Life as well. There seems to be those tides of change and uncertainty and frustration. In the midst of that, pray for Al Hugi, for his family, for Jean, his wife. Pray for the board. They'll be meeting this week, special meeting. Pray for Eric Hugenrad. Pray for Justin Dudney and Nicole and the family. So I invite you to gather with people around you. You don't have to move all the way across the auditorium, but just in groups maybe, just five or six of you, just share a prayer together. Enter into this space of just bringing it to God. It doesn't have to be a profound prayer. It doesn't have to be a complicated prayer. You don't have to address all of the issues. Just a simple prayer of committing these things to God. I invite you to do that. Feel free to move around a little bit. Some of you are pretty spread out, and make sure you keep your masks on. And let's pray together. Spend some time in prayer. Let me, as you begin that prayer time, I just want to read from Ephesians, where Paul also leads the Ephesian church in prayer. It says, "For this reason, I kneel before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth derives its name. I pray that out of his glorious riches he may strengthen you with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith." I'm sorry? Who? I want to invite us to join together in prayer as a congregation as well. And perhaps this might be playing off of a dangerous act, but I'm going to invite you to come up here if you feel led to pray and to lead the congregation in prayer. I want you to do that. The microphone's right here. Normally we wouldn't do that necessarily, or perhaps if you have a word to share, not a soapbox word, but a word from God, a word from Scripture that you can share, that God places on your heart, I want to invite you to offer that to the congregation as well. And in that way, join together as the body of Christ, committing this, all of this, to our God. Feel free to come up. For those of you who are online as well, I invite you to offer your prayers in the chat, and our host can lead you in that as well.
It's on?
It is.
Okay, so the piece that the Lord's been impressing on me with Ukraine is that we see the terrible images and we're just appalled at what's happening. And we see the destruction. And what the Lord keeps impressing on me is that He is sovereign. And He has not forgotten this. This has not passed Him by. He knows. And that we know that He is the master of the universe. He is sovereign. And that even though the mountains shake and the earth quakes, the word of the Lord will stand firm. And that we are to trust, and that we are to intercede, and that we are to be faithful in our prayer, and to not give hope, not to give up hope, but to stand firm.
Mm. Thank you. Bless you.
A verse that really touches me is, "Be still and know that I am God." We just have to be still and know that He is God.
Thank you. Bless you. You all heard that, right? Did you? It's an important word.
So this is a text that has come to my mind through the whole pandemic and through the difficulties we've experienced. And one that I've said is precisely what this little girl shared with us is, "Be still and know that I am God." And it's one that I've shared with my grandkids on sometimes almost a daily basis, picking them up from school. We talk about the different things that are happening. And I've lost the verse here, but oh yeah. After Solomon had finished building the house of the Lord, it says, "If my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray, seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, Then I will hear from heaven, and I will forgive their sin and heal their land.
Thank you.
I've been praying through Psalm 6 this week, and I'd like to read that. Lord, do not rebuke us in your anger or discipline us in your wrath. Have mercy on us, Lord, for we are faint. Heal us, Lord, for our bones are in agony. Our souls are deep in anguish. How long, Lord, how long? Turn, Lord, and deliver us. Save us because of your unfailing love. Among the dead, no one proclaims your name. Who praises you from the grave? We are worn out from our groaning. All night long, we flood our beds with weeping and drench our couch with tears. Our eyes grow weak with sorrow. They fail because of all our foes. Away from us, all you who do evil. For the Lord has heard our weeping. The Lord has heard our cry for mercy. The Lord accepts our prayer. All our enemies will be overwhelmed with shame and anguish. They will turn back and suddenly be put to shame.
Thank you.
So at school, I've been studying a verse. It says, don't worry about anything, instead pray about everything, because tell God what you need and thank him for everything he's done. Even what's happening now, like how it's getting hard in life, we have to, we're going to have to talk to God and pray to him and tell him that even though it's going to get hard, that he's always there for us. He's always going to love you no matter what's happening to us. And he knows what's happening, and he's always in control no matter what.
Good morning. There's a word that's been on my heart for a while, and I've spoken with a few people about it, and I've been just delaying even speaking it because I know speaking it means a commitment. And part of it is not, to be honest, not wanting to commit to it in one sense. Mm. I do it personally, but to do it publicly, it's a different thing. And so the word that I've been receiving over and over and over again, and even when we were in our home group on Friday, we were just kind of talking. We went into a period of lament, and we were talking, and we actually wrote our own lament. And I've just been broken, and I've been really... just feeling the weight of what's happening, not just globally, but more so the weight that I feel is what's happening here at New Life. And I know it requires, for me when I think about it, I think it requires fasting. I think it requires prayer. I think it requires submission in a lot of ways. And so the word that keeps coming to me over and over again, and I've written it out, it's called wait. And wait simply... just waiting on God, and so many people have echoed that this morning, and waiting on God, not passively waiting, but waiting in terms of active waiting. So what does that mean? It means submission, it means prayer, it means coming to God and fully committing everything to him, but it's also weight, as in W-E-I-G-H-T, which means carrying the burdens to God and saying, hey, God, I don't know what to do with this, but I'm putting it at the altar. I remember a couple of weeks ago, Bruce led a beautiful service around the different altars and just putting it all down in front of him and saying, God, I am lost. I'm absolutely at a loss, and I need your help to kind of figure this out. And I think that's sometimes we stand in our own strength, and I think that's what God is calling us to do. And so one of the things I think when I say the public commitment... it's coming here at church, finding a day, and coming in and saying, we're going to pray. We're going to seek the face of God. We're going to turn it back over to him. And I'm thinking, wait, as in the word, so just reading the scriptures, reading the Bible, just kind of like what you did this morning. It's adoration, it's giving praise to him. It's saying, Father, you are the Alpha, you are the Omega, you are the beginning, you are the end. It is intercessory prayer. It is praying, like fully committing and getting lost in prayer. Not just the little popcorn prayers, but praying, committing, turning it over to God. And it is testimony. By the blood of the Lamb, the word of our testimony, we shall overcome. So it's testifying of the goodness of God, that what God is doing in our lives on a daily basis. That's the word that keeps coming to me. And then when all of that gets transformed, the Bible says, take my yoke, my weight upon you. Because my yoke, my burden is easy. The weight of God, but what he puts on us is easy. His burden is light. So that's the word that keeps coming back over and over and over again. And I've tried to kind of run away from it. And it just keeps coming back. I don't know why, but.
Thanks.
So I was just kind of reflecting, you opened today saying that we live in a difficult time. And just reflecting on the past year, we've gone from, you know, starting in the last calendar year, still in the heat in the midst of the pandemic, and then we got hit by the heat wave, and now we've had the flood, and we're dealing with loss in our church community, and we're dealing with a lot of transitions and changes within New Life. And I have found that the last year there's been a lot to be fearful about, and to be anxious about, and to wonder about, and a lot to be uncertain about. And so I have a verse to share, and then some lyrics from a hymn that I would like to share as well. And the verse comes from Psalm 18, verse 2. It says, the Lord is my rock, my fortress, and my deliverer. My God is my rock, in whom I take refuge, my shield and the horn of my salvation, and my stronghold. And the song says, when I fear, my faith will fail. Christ will hold me fast. When the tempter would prevail, he will hold me fast. He will hold me fast. He will hold me fast. For my Savior loves me so, he will hold me fast.
Awesome. Great. Thank you. It's a little bit close.
So God is perfect, and you just have to think right now that he's probably smiling down at us.
All right. Awesome.
I would like to give a quick prayer over the church. And God, I pray that New Life will be a place of peace for a whole lot of people that are hurting because of the pandemic. And I pray that it will be a place of peace for a whole lot of people that are hurting because of the war. And I pray that New Life will just be able to make so many great connections with people who feel like they don't have a home. And I hope that they can just make those connections and they can feel close to you, God.
Yes, Lord. Thank you.
I was just going to say, that we're moving, and thank you for supporting our family, and I'm gonna miss you all.
All right. Bless you.
Okay, let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you with thanksgiving in our heart. Just to tell you, thank you for your love and mercy, my Father. May you cleanse us all that we have done wrong. Jehovah, forgive us because we are faithful. May God, may you create in us a clean heart, O Father, and renew the steadfast spirit within us, O God. Don't cast us away from your presence, O my Father, but help us to walk in your revelation, O mighty Redeemer. We come before you on behalf of Ukraine, O my Father. They are your children, my Father. You knew them even before they were born, O my God.
We cover that country with the blood of the Lamb, Almighty Redeemer, and we speak blessing to each and every person there, Jehovah. We repent the sins of the fathers and the mother of my father, the children of my father, and the youth, Almighty Redeemer. Bless them, my Father. Remember them, mercy, O my God, because you are faithful, my Father. We remember Psalms 23, Jehovah, you are their shepherd, O my Father. You are, they shall lack anything good, O my Father, because you love them, O my God. You are, they are going to lay down in the green pastures, O my Father. Even though they walk through the valley of the shadow of death, O my God, they will fear no evil because you are with them, O my God. You are going to lay a table before the enemy, O my Father, and their cup will overflow, O my God. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow them all the days of their life, O my God. And they shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever and ever and ever. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you.
Let's pray. Dear Holy God, please show us the way that the war in Ukraine and the war between Russia and Ukraine. Please make the war stop. In Jesus Christ's name, amen.
Amen. Thank you. I trust that this has honored God and that it's invited us into his presence so that as we go into this new week, we can go in the strength of God. Perhaps even if we don't feel it, perhaps even if it doesn't make us feel good, but we've witnessed it in a beautiful way this morning, that God is with us. And the blessing on top of all of that is the children have led us. I love that. We've entered into the Lent season this week. Lent season is a portion of the church calendar in which we follow Jesus as he makes his way to Jerusalem, the road of suffering, as he himself walks that road towards his crucifixion. It's a way of suffering. And so I want to invite us to join together in the Lord's Supper and in taking part in that communion. We offer up ourselves to follow Jesus on that road of suffering. And when we take in the bread and the juice, we take in God's grace and mercy as we follow Jesus in that suffering. Even as he invites us into that suffering. It's one of the big lessons, I think, that we are called to learn. In a culture, in a time, in an age where we've had it so good, so much peace, so much wealth, so much comfort. And then God calls us to live in this world to testify not of how good we have it, but to testify of how good God is in the midst of struggle and trial. And so, on the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took bread and he broke it. And he said, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And in the same way, he took a cup. And he said, "This cup is my blood of a new covenant. Do this in remembrance of me. For as long as we eat this bread and drink this cup, We proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. That death is not something that's morbid. It's the very thing that saves us. It's the very thing that is the essence of good news in this world. That Christ, who entered freely into suffering and death, has conquered death and given us the victory of life. So, I invite the attendants to go to each of the stations. There's two in the back, up in the balcony. There's three in the front here. And I invite you to gather in groups of about 10 or so people. And let's join together. And as we recognize the difficulties in our world and in our lives, the struggles, the frustrations that we have, as we take part in this bread and this juice, commit it to Jesus. And know that the blood of Jesus, as we so wonderfully sang earlier, there's power in the blood. And that is what saves us. I invite you to join together. Welcome to this celebration of the Lord's Supper. While the rest of the congregation in the auditorium is taking part of the elements in this celebration, I invite you to gather your bread and your juice, and we are going to celebrate here together. And so take the bread, and as you eat it, remember and believe that the body of our Lord Jesus Christ was given for the forgiveness of all your sins. And then take the juice. Jesus poured out his blood so that you could have life and life forevermore. So take it, drink this juice. Remember and believe that Jesus poured out his blood for the forgiveness of all your sins to redeem you into a brand new life. We now rejoin the live stream of the worship service, and you may have to wait for some of the other groups to finish up, and then we will resume our worship together. Jesus, bring new wine out of me. In the crushing, in the pressing, you are making new wine. In the soil I now surrender, you are breaking new ground. So I yield to you. Thank you.
Whatever, my Lord,
as we close off this service. Lord Jesus, the Lent season begins. It's a time to be with you in a special way, a time to pray, a time to fast, a time to follow you on your way to Jerusalem, to Golgotha, to the final victory over death. God, we're still so divided. We truly want to follow you, but we also want to follow our own desires and lend an ear to the voices that speak about success and about pleasure and about comfort and about power and about influence. Help us to become deaf to those voices and more attentive to your voice, which calls us to choose the narrow road to life. Father, we know that Lent is going to be a very hard time for us. The choice for your way has to be made every moment of our lives. We have to choose thoughts that are your thoughts. We have to choose words that are your words. We have to choose actions that are your actions. There are not times or places without choices. We know how deeply we resist choosing you. And so please, Lord, be with us at every moment and in every place. Give us the strength and the courage to live this season faithfully so that when Easter comes, we'll be able to taste with joy the new life that you have prepared for us. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face of love towards you and give you his peace. Amen. Go in peace.